Kalyani Educational Rhythms proudly presents a series of educational cassettes that will encourage our young listeners to discover for themselves the fascinating world of science. Under these series are the following titles: Air, Water, Motion, Light, Sound, Heat, Electricity, and Magnetism. Our third title today is Motion. I hope, children, these cassettes will enlighten you, and we promise you that you'll enjoy the activities and experiments we deal with. Happy listening and happy learning. Motion. Change of position or place is called motion. Motion occurs when an object changes its position in space. In other words, a body is said to be in motion if it changes its position with respect to its surroundings. But motion is more a relative term than an absolute term. An object may be in motion in regard to another object, and yet two moving objects can be stationary in regard to each other. For example, we may go for a car drive and pass a person standing alongside. We will be in motion as far as the individual standing on the road is concerned. However, we will be at rest in regard to the friend on the seat next to us. So, a moving car is said to be in motion, and when it is at rest, it is supposed to have no motion. Actually, of course, everything on earth is in motion in regard to any fixed point in space. We may think that we are sitting at rest in a chair, but because of earth's rotation, we are moving very fast. Furthermore, we are moving with the earth as it moves on its path around the sun. The sun itself is dragging the earth, the planet we live in, along with it towards a point in distant space.
Everything in the universe is in motion. Even as we sit, we are moving very rapidly because the earth is rotating on its axis. You are moving along with the earth as it revolves around the sun. In addition, the sun, planets in our solar system are involved in general motion of our galaxy within the universe. Apparent motion. The difference in motion between yourself and the object that you are looking at is called apparent motion. For example, suppose you are riding in a car on the highway and another car is moving slightly faster than yours. You will see the other car's apparent motion is smaller than your car. Your car becomes your frame of reference.
You must be aware that all living things move on their own, but all the non-living things need a pull or a push to get into motion. There are so many kinds of movements that you can see around you. Try making a list and you will definitely run out of paper. Children, did you know that all things do not move at the same pace? Some movements are so slow that you will hardly notice them, while others just happen in a flash. To measure how fast or slow a thing moves, we refer to its speed. Speed is the distance something travels in a fixed time. A car moving at the speed of 60 kilometers per hour takes 1 hour to cover that distance. Scientists, however, are more precise and use the term velocity instead of speed. When we say that an object is moving with a constant velocity, we mean that it is moving in a straight line and a constant speed. Therefore, velocity of an object either depends upon the direction of the object or the change in magnitude of distance traveled by the object.
When both speed and direction of a body are constant, the motion of the body is uniform. Thus, motion is said to be uniform if the particle covers equal distance in equal intervals of time. You will be interested to know the speeds at which certain animals move. This has been calculated scientifically. A snail travels at 6 kilometers per hour. A horse at 65 kilometers per hour. A cheetah at 100 kilometers per hour. And a man at 38 kilometers per hour. Did you know that the fastest thing is light? Light travels at the speed of 300,000 kilometers per second. Now, isn't that fast? Let us now do an activity. Try measuring your running speed. You will need a measuring tape, a piece of chalk, a watch, and a friend. Measure a distance of 50 meters with the tape. Mark the two ends with chalk. Now, run the distance while your friend notes the time. Divide the 50 meters by the time noted by your friend, and this will give you your running speed in meters per second. You can also time your journey. Next time you travel by a car, note the time as well as the speedometer reading at the beginning and at the end of your journey. Divide the change in the mileometer reading by the time of travel to get the average speed of your journey. Also, note the speedometer reading. Sometimes it may read 80 kilometers per hour and sometimes 40 kilometers per hour. It may even read 0 kilometers per hour if you are held up in a traffic jam. This is because the speed of a car is constantly changing. The speedometer gives the speed of the car at any point of time, while the speed of the car over the journey gives you the average speed.
Rest and motion. We all know that things do not start moving by themselves. They seem to enjoy being at rest. This tendency of objects to stay where they are is called inertia or inertia of rest. Let us do an activity to understand how an object displays its inertia. You will need a glass, a postcard, and a coin. Place the postcard on the top of the glass. Put the coin in the center of the card. Now, flick the card away with a quick hit. You will see that the stubborn coin refuses to leave its position of rest and drops into the glass. What a stubborn coin! A very important property of inertia is that it depends upon mass. Let us check. You will need a fat dictionary and a thin book. Place the two books side by side on a table. Push the books lightly and then with increasing pressure. You will see that the fat dictionary takes more pressure to move, whereas the thin book easily moves just with a light push.
Liquids also display inertia. To verify this, put a cup of water on a table. When the water is still, suddenly pull the cup. Guess what happens? Some water will spill back due to its tendency to stay at the same place. After this, try doing this. Slide the cup of water on the table. Then, suddenly stop the sliding cup. This time, some water will splash out in the direction in which the cup was sliding. The water splashes forward due to its tendency to keep on moving. In fact, just as things at rest try to remain at rest, moving things try to maintain their motion.
Go for a bicycle ride. While riding a bicycle, suddenly apply the brakes. You will notice that your body will tend to move forward However, take care not to topple over. You can also observe this while traveling in a bus or a car. When the car starts, your body leans backward, while it bends forward when the car stops.
Forms of motion. There are two important forms of motion, the rectilinear and the curvilinear motion. When an object moves in a straight line, it is said to be in a rectilinear motion. But when it is said to move in a curved path, it is called curvilinear motion. Rectilinear motion occurs when objects move freely, whereas in curvilinear motion, objects are pushed sideways by a force. Another possible way to describe this motion is by classifying it into one-dimensional motion, two-dimensional motion, and three-dimensional motion. One-dimensional motion is along a straight line. A particle moving along a curved path in a plane has two-dimensional motion. A particle moving in space has three-dimensional motion. A ball thrown or dropped vertically from some height follows a straight path and is an example of one-dimensional motion. Lastly, a kite flying in the sky on a windy day is an example for three-dimensional motion.
Force. A pull or a push is necessary to start or stop a movement. Such a pull or a push is called a force. A force, however, does not always start an object moving or stop a moving object. Force speeds up or slows down a moving body, thereby changing its motion. A force fights against the inertia of a body. Therefore, more force is required to change the motion of heavier objects. Let us check. You will need a wheelbarrow and some heavy bricks. Push the wheelbarrow gently. It will roll easily. Stop it with one hand. You will feel a gentle reaction. Now, load it with some heavy bricks. You will see that it will not move as easily as before. This happens because of inertia. Now, apply force till you overcome the inertia of the barrow and it starts rolling. Stop the motion again with one hand. Your one hand will not be able to stop the motion of the wheelbarrow. This happens only because more force is required to overcome the inertia of a heavy body. You can try doing the activity with different loads in the wheelbarrow. The direction of force with regard to motion of a body is very important. A force applied in the direction of the motion increases its speed. The increase in the speed of a body in a fixed time is called acceleration. The greater the force is applied, the higher is the acceleration produced. The opposite of acceleration is called deceleration. It is the rate at which a moving body slows down. To slow down a moving body, a force has to be applied in a direction opposite to the direction of motion.
Newton's laws of motion. In 1687, Sir Isaac Newton, one of the greatest scientists of all times, gave a very good explanation of force, motion, and inertia. The first law deals with inertia. The second law defines force. In the third law of motion, Newton showed that whenever a force acts on an object, there is always an equal reaction that opposes the original force. For example, if you push a wall with your hand will experience a resistance. This is the force with which the wall pushes you back. It is equal to your push, but acts in the opposite direction. To start moving, you need something solid to push against. You push the ground with your feet. The ground in turn gives you a forward push which sets you in motion.
Children, I would like to repeat the three laws of Newton. The first law deals with inertia. The second law defines force. In the third law of motion, Newton showed that whenever a force adds on an object, there is always an equal reaction that opposes the original force. For example, if you push a wall with your hand will experience a resistance. This is the force with which the wall pushes you back. It is equal to your push but acts in the opposite direction. Now, let us learn some more about Newton's laws. Newton's first law states that any body moving uniformly in a straight line will remain in uniform motion unless it is acted upon by some outside force. The property of matter that tends to keep it in motion is called its inertia. Both acceleration and deceleration require overcoming the inertia of an object.
Newton's second law tells us what happens when a force is applied to a moving body. The change which any force makes in the motion of an object depends upon the size of the force and the mass of the object. The greater the force, the greater the acceleration. The greater the mass of the object, the smaller the acceleration. The motion or the change of motion takes place in the direction in which the force acts.
Newton's third law states that for every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction. This is the principle behind jet propulsion engines. For example, when hot gases escape the rocket engine during takeoff, the rocket is propelled upward. The downing motion of the gases from the rocket generates an upward reaction of the rocket. This reaction helps the rocket overcome air resistance and fly into space. Another example is when a bullet is fired from a rifle, the firing of the bullet is the action and the recoil of the rifle is the reaction. Friction. Children, have you ever seen that a football stops rolling on the ground after moving some distance? Let us find out why. Well, when a football rolls on the ground applies a force to stop its motion. This is called the force of friction. A frictional force appears whenever two surfaces come in contact. It is less in case of smooth surfaces and more with rough ones. To check this, roll a marble on the floor. Put a mark where it stops. Measure the distance traveled by the marble. Repeat the same on a graveled path. Compare the measured distances. You will see that the marble on the floor travels a greater distance, whereas the marble on the graveled floor travels only a short distance. Therefore, friction is actually the resistance to motion. One of the most common things that causes friction is air. This is the reason why automobiles and aeroplanes are streamlined in shape. It reduces the friction. However, friction is also a help because unless friction existed between our feet and the earth, we would not be able to walk. We would keep slipping and falling.
At times, friction can cause great problems. This can be reduced by three methods. First is by lubrication, by putting lubricating oil between the two surfaces, friction can be reduced. Secondly, rotation. Rotating objects such as roller bearings, ball bearings, and wheels also greatly reduce friction. Thirdly, by streamlining. Regular lines or streamlines are made when a body passes through a fluid. Thus, the shape of automobiles is so designed so that it resembles the streamlined pattern. Due to this shape, the resistance offered by the fluid is at a minimum. Gravity. Have you ever wondered what makes things fall? Well, a stone does not move sideways without being pushed. It does not move upwards unless thrown or pulled up. But if you lift a stone and let it go, it will always fall to the ground. This is due to the force of gravity. It is this force with which everything is pulled towards the earth. The acceleration is due to the gravitational force and is calculated equal to 9.8 meters per second. Gravitational force, let us now do an activity. You will need a big stone, a small stone, a tall building, and the help of a friend. Drop the two stones from the same height from the top of the building. Ask your friend to note which one of the stones reaches first. You will be surprised by the result. The smaller stone reaches first. Although it seems that the heavier stone will reach first because more force acts on it, you should remember that its inertia is also more. All objects fall to the ground at the same rate.
Children, aren't you enjoying all this? I'm learning so much more and more about science. I did not know that there was so much to learn about motion. We see it all around us, and yet we do not know that there was so much scientific explanation about it. Well, what happens when you throw a ball straight up? It falls down vertically. Now, what happens when you throw the ball at an angle? Yes, when you throw a ball at an angle, it first goes up into the air because of the force with which you throw it. Then it starts to curve downwards due to the pull of gravity. The curved path traveled by the ball is called a trajectory. T-R-A-J-E-C-T-O-R-Y. Trajectory.
Centrifugal force. To know what this force is, let us do an experiment. You will need a strong rubber band and a stone. Tie the stone to the rubber band. Whirl the stone around in a circle at an arm's length. You will be able to see the stretch in the rubber. This stretch is caused by a force which acts on the stone directly outwards from the center of the circle, and it is called the centrifugal force. Centrifugal force comes into play whenever an object is moving in a circle. Now, whirl the stone faster. The stretch on the rubber will increase because the centrifugal force increases with the speed of rotation. While rotating, suddenly let go of the rubber band. Now guess, in which direction does the stone fly? Well, a centrifugal force occurs because a rotating object wants to keep moving in a straight line but is pulled around in a circle. This is why the stone speeds off in a straight line as soon as it is released.
You can try doing another activity. You can make a water trap. You'll need a plastic cup, a 2 feet long piece of string, a pair of scissors, and some water. Cut out 6 inches from the string. Make 2 holes in opposite sides at the top of the cup and tie the string to make a handle. Tie the longer string to the center of the handle. Fill half the cup with water. Swing the cup over your head in a full circle. If you do it fast enough, the water will remain trapped inside the cup, even when it is upside down. This is due to the centrifugal force, which pushes the water in the outward direction away from the center. While doing this experiment, did you feel the pull in your arm when you were swinging the cup of water? This is due to another force called the centripetal force, C-E-N-T-R-I-P-E-T-A-L, centripetal force. It is equal to the centrifugal force, but acts in the opposite direction. These two forces always occur together. The centrifugal force balances the force of gravity in the solar system. In this case, the gravitational force acts as the centripetal force. Hence, this justifies Newton's third law, which states that every action has an equal and opposite reaction. We just learned, therefore, that forces work in pairs.
Some common movements. For starters, walking. When you walk, you always have one foot at ease on the ground. As you push the ground with your foot, the ground pushes you forward. This is how you take a step forward. You can have a little fun arranging a walking race among your friends when you become the referee. Well, what should be your criteria for disqualifying a participant who starts to run? That's tricky now, isn't it? You can differentiate between running and walking very easily. While running, you have at least 1 foot above the ground, whereas while walking, you have at least 1 foot on the ground. Do you know why a caterpillar does not run? Well, the answer is right here. A caterpillar has 100 legs. It moves its legs in a wave so that they do not get entangled. This makes it walk very slow. There's no question of it running. The second motion is jumping. Human beings can jump easily. Do you know why? Our arms and legs have thick cords called tendons that join the muscles to the bones. Therefore, we jump with the help of tendons. You would be surprised to know that red kangaroos can jump a distance of over 12 meters at a height of more than 3 meters.
Another motion is turning. While turning, all things experience a force that tries to make them go forward in a straight line. The sharper the turn, the higher the velocity. The more is this force. To balance this force, our bodies lean when we turn around a corner. You can observe this phenomenon next time you turn around a corner on your bicycle. Did you know that roads are banked at the outer curve of a bend to help cars turn at high speeds? I'm sure you didn't know it.
Now to spinning. Spinning objects rotate around a fixed direction or axis and tend to resist any change in this direction. To check, let us do an activity. Lift the front wheel of your bicycle off the ground. Spin the wheel around and try to move the handlebars from side to side. Well, you will feel a force trying to stop you. The speed of spinning depends on how the mass of the spinning body is distributed. You can try doing another activity. You will need a revolving chair, 2 bricks, and a friend. Sit on the chair with a brick in either hand. Now, stretch your hands outward. Ask your friend to turn the chair slowly. As the chair rotates, suddenly pull your hands to your chest. You will see that the chair will start rotating faster because of the redistribution of mass.
Another motion is flying. Let us do a small activity. Hold a long piece of paper between your fingers so that the free end curls down. Blow over the curved surface of the paper. You will notice that the rushing air will lift up the paper. This is called air lift. All flying things need to be airlifted. When an aeroplane runs on the runway, the air rushing over its wings gives it an uplift. Birds flap their wings to make the air flow over the wings and get the airlift. Observe the flight of different birds. You will find that some birds flap their wings often than others, and some can go very high up in the sky. Note the differences in their body shapes and weights and how they use these to their advantage while flying. Enjoy watching the movements of a bird while it takes off and lands.
Yet another movement is floating. If you drop a stone and a cork in a tub of water, the stone sinks and the cork floats. Things float when the upward push of a liquid or a gas called upthrust is equal to the weight of the floating body. Balloons also float in air, but only if they are filled with a gas called helium, because helium is lighter than air.
Swimming is another beautiful motion. Have you children ever watched a fish swim? Stand in front of an aquarium. Note down the names, shapes, and sizes of various fish in the aquarium. Now, observe how a fish uses its fins and tail to swim, dive, and turn around. Fish use their side fins to guide them when they turn, dive, or rise. A deep sea diver's flippers work like fins. Do you know how ducks swim? Well, ducks have webbed feet that act very much like fins. They push the water with their feet and move forward. Ducks also have oily feathers that help them remain afloat. And now on to simple machines that help motion. A machine is any device that overcomes a force at one point by letting you apply a force at some other convenient point. A machine is something that helps you do work more easily. A knife and a pair of tongs are examples of very simple machines that you see in everyday life. They're machines because in both you have to apply a force on the handle to cut or grip by the front edge.
Levers. A lever is a simple machine for performing a function. It consists of a rod or plank that is free at both ends. It also consists of some steady objects on which the plane can rest. The braced or fixed part is called the fulcrum. The distance from the load to the fulcrum is called the load arm. The distance between the fulcrum and the lifting force is called the effort arm. A lever helps lift weight with less effort. The seesaw is an example of a first-class lever. In this, the fulcrum lies between the load and the effort. A wheelbarrow and a bottle opener are examples of second-class levers, where the load lies between the effort and the fulcrum. The knife and tongs are examples of third-class levers. Here, the effort is applied between the load and the fulcrum. Now try doing an activity. Make your own seesaw. You will need a candle, a long nail, a matchbox, a pair of tongs, a tin foil, a pair of scissors, two glasses, and a newspaper. Heat the nail by holding it with the tongs. You must take the help of an elder person. Push the hot nail through the middle of the candle. Cut out the riders for your seesaw from the tin foil, and then spread the newspaper on the table. Keeping the glasses close to each other, balance the nail with the candle between the two glasses. You can light both ends of the candle and enjoy watching your little rider's seesaw.
Wheels. We see wheels everywhere, on cars, bicycles, trucks, trains, everywhere we see wheels around us. Today, wheels are taken so much for granted that it is difficult to think of a time when the wheel had not been invented. But what exactly does a wheel do? Well, a wheel lessens the friction offered by the ground, thereby making movement easier and smoother. A simple activity will show you how this happens. You will need the following things: a fat book, four round pencils, a clipboard, and a rubber band. That's all. Put the book on the clipboard. Attach the rubber band to the clip of the board. Try to remove the board by pulling at the rubber band. Note the stretch in the rubber band. Now, put the board with the book on the four pencils. Again, pull it. You will find that the board moves easily. Note the stretch in the band. It would be much less than before. The pencils in this case act like wheels and reduce friction, thus making motion easier. So next time you see a wheel, you think of what you have heard in this cassette.
Pulley. P-U-L-L-E-Y. A pulley is a wheel over which a rope or a belt is passed for the purpose of transmitting energy and doing work. When the pulley carries a rope, its edge is grooved. But if it carries a belt, the edge is barrel-shaped, and the belt rides on the highest part of the rim. Now, can we try an activity which you will definitely enjoy? Next time anybody calls you a weakling, just try this. Take two rods, tie a strong rope to one of the rods and wrap it around both of them. Ask your two friends to hold the rods and pull them apart while you pull the free end of the rope. See who wins. Isn't this a good trick? But can you explain how it works? Indeed, no matter how hard your friends try, they will never be able to pull the rods apart. This is because the rods and the rope act like a pulley system. They help you overcome their big pull with a little effort.
And now on to gears. Gears are machines that transfer force from one point to another by toothed wheels. Gears in a car carry forces from the engine to the wheels. Gears can operate in two ways. They can make large forces from small ones, as also small forces from large ones.
Displacement. Since we have defined motion as change of place, the question of displacement arrives immediately. Displacement is defined as distance moved by the object in a specified direction. We must give special attention to the word specified direction. When an object is moving in a straight line, then its position can be located on either side of its origin. Generally, movement in the left side is taken as negative and movement in the right side is taken as positive. If the position of the object changes from x1 to x2, then the displacement d is given by x1 minus x2, or final position minus initial position. the sign of displacement, a small d in inverted commas, tells us the direction in which the object has been shifted.
And so, we have learned so much about motion. It has been defined that matter consists of space and motion. Thus, we see that without motion, there would have been no creation, no universe. The very identity of matter is inseparable from motion. No motion, no matter. No matter, no universe. But we see a lot of things at rest. The table, the chair, the wall, the fan, the picture. Nothing is moving. They are made of matter. Is this matter without motion? No. The atoms inside these things are full of motion. Every electron is moving with tremendous speed inside every atom. But in restricted sense of everyday science, a body is said to be in motion if it changes its position with respect to its surroundings. I repeat, a body is said to be in motion if it changes its position with respect to its surroundings. So, a moving car is said to be in motion, and when it is at rest, it is supposed to have no motion. And when a body is not moving, it is at rest also. A building is at rest with respect to another building, but both are moving always along with the earth around the sun and the earth's own axis. Wasn't it really fascinating to learn so much about motion? I've learnt a lot today. And isn't this a great way of learning? Instead of poring through so many books and so many pages, you can do experiments and learn along. Happy learning, and see you on our next cassette.